It's time for the 420 Radio News, covering the latest headlines in consumer cannabis, medical marijuana, and industrial hemp. Transcripts of 420 Radio News are available daily on our website at 420radio.org. Now, here's Priscilla Simon.
Hey folks, it's your 420 Radio News for Wednesday, July 23rd, 2014. So it's official! The Oregon Secretary of State's office has confirmed that New Approach Oregon has submitted more than enough valid signatures to qualify their marijuana legalization initiative for the 2014 election in November. The Control, Regulation, and Taxation of Marijuana and Industrial Hemp Act will legalize the personal possession of marijuana and marijuana products by adults age 21 and older, including 1 ounce of dried usable marijuana away from the home, 8 ounces or a half pound of dried usable marijuana at the home, 16 ounces or a pound of marijuana infused edibles, 72 ounces or a six pack of marijuana infused liquids, and 1 ounce of marijuana concentrate. Oregon will also allow home cultivation of 4 plants and create a wide open commercial system for marijuana with taxes capped at $35 per ounce. Oregon joins Alaska in voting on statewide marijuana legalization this November and Florida voting on medical marijuana. More details can be found at newapproachoregon.com.
Yes, yes, we are so excited here in Oregon to have the opportunity to vote on this. And again, at half past, we'll have Anthony Johnson, the chief petitioner of the campaign, joining us in studio to take your live questions through chat, or you can call us up and ask your live questions about the New Approach Oregon proposal. You know, there's a whole bunch. I really hope that this passes. I really expect it to pass. And I just... partially, you know, for the legalization aspect, but also partially for the people who counseled Oregon to not do it in 2014 and to wait till 2016. It will be really nice to be able to say, I told you so.
Illinois opened up its extremely restrictive medical marijuana program this week to cover children suffering from intractable epilepsy. Governor Pat Quinn signed a new law allowing doctors to give permission for minor patients to use medical marijuana with a parent's permission. Minors will only be allowed to have non-smokable forms of marijuana. The new law will go into effect in January, which is when regulators believe they will have the broader medical marijuana program operational for all qualifying patients. Illinois will not allow for personal cultivation of medicine, and qualifying for the medical marijuana program will be more difficult than almost any other medical marijuana state.
Yeah, this is, you know, Illinois just basically trying to cover their butt when it comes to this overwhelming emotional need to help these kids with epilepsy. It's just, it's undeniable when you bring these kids who are seizing 100 times a day into a state house and shame a legislator that they can't help but want to help those kids. This is something that should have been written to law into the first place, and it should be available in all 50 states. But it does prove something. It does prove that when those opponents of medical marijuana were, you know, they came against us in the 90s and said, oh, there's no evidence. We don't have any evidence of this. We need scientific study. It needs to go through the FDA. You're just cherry picking anecdotes. Funny how that turned around when it was epileptic kids and these people could approve these CBD-only laws and approve this change in Illinois without all the scientific evidence, only going off of anecdotes, only going off emotional cases. Hey, I'm glad they did. I'm glad emotion swayed the day. But I just wonder why it takes an epileptic kid and why a person, an adult in pain, doesn't have that same power.
Deb Green, the 65-year-old retired woman who camped all night to buy Seattle's first legal marijuana, has donated her purchase to the city's Museum of History and Industry. Green donated her $40 purchase of 2 grams of marijuana, as well as the t-shirt she was wearing and the book she read in line at Cannabis City, Seattle's first legal marijuana store. The museum will display the marijuana and artifacts alongside others it has collected as part of a traveling exhibit for April of 2015 dedicated to exploring prohibition.
And how much more perfect could it be that the first person to buy weed in Seattle legally was named Green?
that worked out really nice.
Yeah. $40 for 2 grams is awfully steep, but you know, we'll be talking about that tax situation in behind the headlines here coming up right after this next break, examining, you know, just how high Washington's taxes actually are. And even there in Colorado, the taxes are 15% excise, 10% sales tax plus local sales taxes. What kind of prices are you finding there, Priscilla, in Colorado?
Yeah, truthfully, it's about, I don't know, like $50 or so for an eighth, which is, I think, is about right. I mean, I'd rather buy that at a store than waiting around some shoddy parking lot for some shoddy dude and some shoddy weed.
Yeah, it's something. So, it's something when the prices are like close to the black market, right, or close to the gray market, because then you can say, well, $50 in the parking lot for some got some, or $50 at the store where I can choose from all these different things that have been inspected and have labels. That's an easy pick.
Yeah.
But if the choice
is
$50 an eighth from the parking lot versus $125 an eighth in the store, now you got some wiggle room. So we hope Washington gets its supply problems fixed and that those prices can come down soon. I know when Oregon passes our legalization with taxes capped at $1.25 a gram, those prices will have to come down.
Yeah. In other Seattle news, a new study shows that even marijuana legalization doesn't change some of the racist and classist enforcements of marijuana laws. Since I-502 legalized possession of marijuana in December 2012, analysis of 82 tickets for public use of marijuana issued in the first 6 months of 2013 found that 36% ticketed were African American, compared to blacks making up just 8% of Seattle's population. 46% of those ticketed had indications of homelessness, and over two-thirds ticketed were under the age of 40. Most tickets were issued in the parks of Seattle's downtown core, where many homeless people gather.
Well, this just indicates, or just kind of reiterates, what happens with drug law enforcement in general. You know, the reason that black people are picked up a lot more for marijuana smoking, oftentimes in the cities, is because they're living in places where it's, you know, urban and congested, and there is no basement or, you know, place to go smoke, right? So they get caught smoking out on the stoop. Whereas the white kids in the suburbs, why, you know, they've got a basement, they got a backyard, they got wherever they want to go. So, I mean, that is part of it. And it just goes to illustrate that even though we are legalizing, there's still a long way to go, because we're not truly legal until we're equal. And that is, we got to have the same rights as beer drinkers and cigar smokers. If I'm a cigar smoker, even though smoking is extremely restricted these days, there are still places I can go and smoke a cigar. I can smoke it in the park in some places, right? So we've got to give people a place to legally smoke. It seems ridiculous to me that the person who's inside smoking in their house isn't hurting anybody. They're fine. They're legal. But the homeless guy in the park, off in the corner, probably not even bugging anybody, he's got to be, you know, ticketed. He's got to be punished for some reason. Let's have some designated smoking areas, designated toking areas for some of these people to be able to use. It just seems unfair. And again, it leads to this disproportionate enforcement, because you're going to find more black folks in the cities, or you're going to find more homeless people that are toking, they don't have a place to go. Legalization needs to treat us all equally. Just shows that we still have some ways to go.
Yeah. Meanwhile, in Philadelphia, since the city council overwhelmingly voted to decriminalize marijuana possession 1 month ago, 262 citizens were busted for possession. The council's 13-3 vote will overcome a veto from Mayor Michael Nutter, who opposes the measure but has yet to act on it. But the city police commissioner vows to keep arresting people for possession even if the measure becomes a law. The fuck? 200 of the 264 were arrested and later released without bail. 140 of the 264 were only charged with possession and no other crime, and most of the rest were only charged with other marijuana-related offenses, such as paraphernalia or intent to deliver. However, during the same period last year, 476 people were charged with possession in Philadelphia. Racial breakdown of the arrests is unknown, but previous reports found 83% of possession arrests in Philadelphia are of African Americans. One place where there wasn't a single marijuana arrest was a weekend fish concert where marijuana use by young white people was glaringly obvious.
You know, I can't wait for the day that I'm watching NBC Nightly News and Brian Williams breaks the middle of a story to say, "The fuck?" That would be great.
Seriously.
But yeah, you're right. It does. The police commissioner said, even if the city passes this, even if the mayor vetoes it and the city council, overcomes the veto and that makes it the law of the city police commissioner says he'll still bust people based on the state law. And this is despite the fact that everywhere else in Pennsylvania, the cities have basically said, look, we'll issue a summons, a ticket, basically, to people that they have to go to court or whatever. We're not going to arrest people. Only in Philadelphia where they do this. And given the 83% racial breakdown of it being African Americans, you can see exactly why they want to keep doing that. It's that they can keep their thumb on certain neighborhoods, on certain people, be able to get them in the system, get their fingerprints, and harass them. The fact that they're not busting the white kids at the Fish concert also makes it pretty damn obvious.
Despite offering free weed to petition signatures, activists in San Jose, California came up only a little more than two-thirds of the signatures they needed to place a referendum on new dispensary regulations on the ballot. Under the new regulations, marijuana dispensaries are zoned to areas representing less than 1% of the city's area, putting about 70 of the city's 80 dispensaries out of business. On Friday at 4:20 p.m., the activists who had claimed to have gathered 75,000 of the over 33,000 signatures they needed found that they were about 10,000 signatures shy of the quota. Dave Hodges, owner of the All-American Cannabis Club and proponent of the referendum, told San Jose Mercury News, quote, "At some locations, 75 to 80% of the people who told us they were registered voters actually weren't," end quote. Most current shops will have until July 2015 to find a new location or close.
Well, what a surprise. The people right? that were trying to bribe people for signatures, hey, we'll give you free pot for a signature, found out that a lot of the people signing them were given bonus signatures. What a surprise. Oh my God. This shows you once again that this is why you need professionals running your signature gathering. And, I'm sorry for the people of San Jose that are going to have far less access to medical marijuana, but, you just got to pick better leadership, I guess.
Yeah. Different plan. And voters in South Portland, Maine will likely be voting on legalization of marijuana in the city. Last year, its larger neighbor, Portland, voted to legalize, and activists are currently working to present petitions for legalization in York and Lewiston. South Portland City Clerk certified that over 959 ballot signatures have been submitted on the petition. However, the first step in the process is that the City Council has the opportunity to pass the initiative, which seems unlikely as they have already signaled their opposition to the measure. In that case, under the law, the initiative goes before voters in November. The initiative also declares the city's support for legalization of marijuana in the entire state of Maine, a proposal that will likely be placed before the voters in 2016.
All right, for South Portland, let's get all the Portlands in the world legalized. I'm for that.
This is
kind of a symbolic thing because under the city law, it would be legal, but under the state law, it would still be illegal. You still have that conflict going on. But Maine is pretty easy going for marijuana as it is. You have to have over like 25 plants growing before you're going to get a felony. They're decrimmed up to an ounce. So things are already pretty good. They're just going to get better. And this shows you how the professionals do it. They don't run out and try to just do a statewide legalization first thing off the bat. They start building up the cities, right? Let's get the biggest city, Portland. They got that in 2013. Now let's go after three of the larger cities in South Portland, York, and Lewiston. Build that local support, then go for statewide in 2016. They will do it. Mark my words. Hey! That bell tells us that it is officially 420 in America's cannabis capital, Colorado. Priscilla Sybin's already got the vape pen out. She's got an important safety meeting to get to, and we'll be back with Behind the Headlines, taking a look at Washington and Colorado taxes right after this. See ya, silly. Radio, the home of marijuana experts.